concerning the Mardi Gras outreach, I must know no later than next Sunday if you are going. I think we've got 12. How many here in the room know that you're going? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Oh, we just added another one. Praise God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So we got 7 here. I know there's several downstairs. So that, I think that brings to about 13 our number so far. I'm excited. I believe God's got some great things in store. Between now and next Sunday, we'll need to register everybody. We'll have some meetings and some times of prayer. I believe God's got some great things in store for us. And we're going to get some shirts made up. You can get a shirt down there from them. You know, that's all well and good. But we're going to get some shirts made up here. Troy was telling me that Wednesday night they came up with a slogan and said, put up or shut up for the year. I like it already, and it's based on the scripture, woe is me if I don't preach the gospel. So I think a nice black shirt and big white letters that says, put up or shut up. And then on the back, woe is me if I do not preach this gospel in the scripture ever. I think that's going to be pretty awesome. Amen. Put up or shut up. And so you don't have to go on the trip to get one of those. We'll let you know how much they're going to cost and everything, but I think that's going to be awesome. Bible study tonight, 6 o'clock. Some interesting things to look at and talk about tonight and to pray together. Lift each other up to the Lord. One more week remaining from today. Several people are asking me, next Sunday night, are we going to eat meat? If you want to, next Sunday night, that'll be fine. If God's leading you to go on past the next Sunday, then it'll be on next Sunday. But next Sunday night, we'll be bringing this, as far as the 21-day part of it, to a close. Amen? All right, take your Bibles, would you please? Turn to the book of Ephesians, chapter 4. Not as many verses to read today. Ephesians 4, 11 through 16 says this, and he himself gave some to be apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, and some pastors and teachers, for the equipping of the saints for the work of ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ, till we all come to the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, to a perfect man, to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ, that we should no longer be children, tossed to and fro and carried about with every wind of doctrine, by the trickery of man, in the cunning craftiness of deceitful plotting, but speaking the truth in love, we may grow up in all things into Him who is the head, even Christ, from whom the whole body, joined and knit together by what every joint supplies, according to the effective working by which every part does its share. Are you listening to this? Causes growth of the body for the edifying of itself in love. I want to read that last part. From whom the whole body, joined and knit together by what every joint supplies, according to the effective working by which every part does its share, causes growth of the body for the edifying of itself in love. Lord God, I just ask for your help today. I pray for the presence and the peace of mind to be able to deliver to your people your words today. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Before we get into this, I want to just say this by way of clarification. I see from time to time some of y'all will post things by Brother Clendenin on Facebook and emails, different ones will quote, and I see video clips by other people from other organizations that they post. And I just want to let y'all know, except for some of you that have been hanging around here since the early 90s, Brother Clendenin, I started listening to Brother Clendenin in 1990. And effectively that led to our first church split, because there were some people that were highly offended by the preaching of that old preacher. But I got the idea from that old preacher 20 plus years ago that church is not where you go. It's who you are. And you don't go to church for what the church can give you. You go to church so that you can get what you need to go out and be the church. And so it leads me to say things like this. If you're only coming to church to get ministered to, you're coming for the wrong reasons, and you're probably at the wrong church. Now understand me quickly, because I think that any person who works in a hospital or hangs out around hospitals would agree with me. The purpose of people going to the hospital is not to go there and just stay at the hospital. Right? You go there for what? Get well and do what? Leave. And go out and live. That's really the purpose of the church. Yes, people do come that need to be ministered to. But I believe that idea that I'm going to, you know, I've had people, and you may think ill of me for doing this, but I don't return phone calls when I get a message on the machine that says, I'd like to know what your church offers. You know, I would just like to simply say, Southeast Christian. Now, I'm not being ugly when I say that, but the truth of the matter is, if you're looking for what we offer, if that's your thrust, you're probably not going to like what we offer, because we are the Southwest Airlines of churches. And I don't believe in being small just for the sake of being small. But I do believe that what we end up doing, if we're not careful, if we get away from what God wants us to be, we're no longer a ministry, we're an entertainment center. And after a while, we just come and we give our money because it's a pretty good show. Right? And on top of that, where can you go and get a really good show, and when you die, you get to go to heaven? Now, the purpose of what we're going to teach about, starting with last Sunday, carrying on into today, and probably next Sunday, is what is this all about? Why does the church, not the building, but the body, why does it exist? First of all, let me show you what Paul says right off the bat. Paul is very quiet, and he's very slow about what he shows us. I just go on. The first thought that I want to give you this morning is this. Everyone does not have the same office or work in the ministry of the church. Talk with pastor friends of mine, and notice when I say pastors, not preachers, pastors. And they would tell you quickly that if preaching was all there was to it, pastoring would be easy. Over the course of 23 years, I've watched people come and go from the church. And a lot of guys come in and they say, I feel the call of God on my life to be a preacher. And then what they end up really, in the end of it all, what they want is a pulpit. Okay? They want a pulpit and they want the position of that. Or other people want the title, etc., of what all of that entails. But the truth of the matter is, folks, according to God's workings, or God's word, the workings of the church, not everyone does not have the same office or work in the ministry of the church. Now, let's look at what Paul lays out for you. And y'all pray for me this morning, because I'm kind of offset by this now. Because it's kind of hard to get this across without my visual aids, and so I don't want to get bound to that. The second thing that is laid out for us here is what, and for the sake of today, I'm going to lay it out as the fivefold ministry. Okay? The fivefold ministry. I don't actually believe it's a fivefold ministry. I believe that actually it's only four, but most people know it as the fivefold ministry. All right? Most people know it as the fivefold ministry. Hold on, brother. You think it's this? No. All right. Most people call it the fivefold ministry. The first one in the step of this is that of apostle. Now, most Baptists, Presbyterians, Methodists, people of that ilk, non-Pentecostal, they believe that this office was done away with, just like they believe that all the gifts of the Spirit were done away with. When the last one of the 12 died, then the last of the gifts and the last of the apostleship died with it. How many of you have heard that before? Okay, you've been taught that. However, here's a problem, is that you have a man who was not one of the 12, but yet he says that he was an apostle, talking about Paul, and he says that he was an apostle born out of time. And what did that mean? He was not chosen as one of the original 12, okay, that walked with Jesus, and yet we all know that his experience was that on the road to Damascus, Paul did see Jesus. Amen? You remember that story there in the book of Acts? And Paul saw Jesus, and the sight of Jesus in all of his glory, it blinded him. And he, you know that story, okay? Now, here's what we see that happens here. Here Paul comes along now, many years later, thank you, my brother. Many years later, okay, now we got something going on here now. Thank you, my brother. Many years later on, here is this Apostle Paul, and he's laying out the workings of the church, and the first thing that he says is that the first thing that God gives to the church is the office of apostle. Now, here's our problem, because we get hung up on this word, and we think that only those who walked with Jesus, or we'll stretch it to allow Paul to identify himself as an apostle, but only that special group could be apostles, and we don't understand what the word means. And that word apostle literally means one who is an overseer or one who is over a group. So literally you could say that if we had somebody that we could think of, you might say that Billy Graham is the apostle of the Southern Baptist Convention. Would that make sense to you? Because you kind of look to him as being the leader. Okay? I really felt like, because I got to meet the man personally, Scotty, Bruce, Brother Tim. I don't know if anybody else here ever went down to Texas with him. Am I missing anybody who went with us down there once? Anyway, you all got to meet Brother Clendenin. And if ever there was a man that I believe genuinely had the call to be an apostle on his life, that man had the call of God on his life. Now, how so? Well, I'll tell you this. Apostles are not greedy or selfish. In other words, they don't get a position and then say, okay, I'm at the top, and now everybody bow down to me, and don't anybody do anything to disrupt my position at the top. See, that's how a lot of people are once they get that position, once they get that title. But I want you to know something that I know about this man. When he was 35 years old, he started a church there in Beaumont, Texas. He was in the Assemblies of God, and the Assemblies of God already had an assembly church there in Beaumont, and they told him in 1959, I think it was, we don't need another Assembly of God church here. We've already got one. But here's what he said. I can't help what you already have here. God has told me to start a church in this town. And so without their blessing, he started that church there. 34 years later, at the age of 69 years old, Brother Clendenin resigned that church, turned it over to his son-in-law, Brother Robert Turnage. He preached here in this church in 2001. Some of y'all remember that. He turned the church over to his son-in-law, and he and his wife went into full-time missions work going around the world. Now, how many of you know that at 69 years old, you typically don't resign and start another endeavor? And here's what the endeavor was, and this is why we supported that work. We still do to this day, as far as I know. If we don't, we need to be. Here's what they did, and this is truly the mark of an apostle. I'm not really crazy any longer about supporting American missionaries going to foreign countries. And here's why. It costs multiple times more to take care of an American missionary, say in the Philippines. It'll cost somewhere around $5,000 to $10,000 a month for an American missionary and his family to be in the Philippines. But you can support a Filipino pastor for about $100 a month, he and his entire family. And here's what you get. You get somebody who already speaks the language. They already are adjusted to the climate. They know the culture. They know the terrain. You see what I'm saying? There's a great difference. Now, here's our problem. Though sometimes you don't always have somebody to train them. And Brother Clendenin assembled this thing called the School of Christ. How many of y'all have been through the School of Christ? I know Brother Scott, he's left the room, but he'd been through it. I think Bruce had been through it, maybe Cheryl. But here's what they did. They would go into a country, And for 30 to 60 days, sometimes 90 days, they would meet with all these pastors and evangelists, missionaries, workers, and they would train them in this fashion to do the work of the church, and then they would leave and leave them to do. That's what an apostle does. An apostle is one who is an overseer, and he's willing to bring others up behind him, and he's not threatened by other people's growth. Amen? He's not threatened by other people's growth or success. By the way, do you know that Christians, we seem to have a hard time handling our brothers and sisters in Christ when they have success? Amen? Now, the second part then of the church, the fivefold ministry, is that of prophet. Now, again, here's where the Baptist church, the Presbyterians, the Methodists, etc., non-Pentecostal Protestants, we struggle with this word here, because we want to say that this word here means a preacher. And it means, what we wanted to say here is one who is preaching God's word. That's what a prophet is. And yes, sometimes in the Bible, when the word prophesy is put in, it's actually mistranslated, because that word ought to be a proclaimer instead of a prophet. But in this particular case here in the Greek, this word prophet means one who foretells. Now, you all have been around this church long enough to know that we're going to just preach the whole counsel of the world. We're not going to worry about what the denomination says. And so, in God's order, there has to be somebody who's an overseer, but then there has to also be somebody who will come in and speak and be willing to speak prophetically. The prophet, one who foretells. I believe that what's happening right now in America is either, number one, we have so made the prophet look so strange that nobody wants to hear him, or we've had so many quacks on TV who've gotten on there and said stupid stuff that no one wants to listen to what God is really saying anymore, and the church is running away from it. Even the Pentecostal is running away from it. We've got so many people on there. We got the guys on TV, I have a word. God showed me that somebody has a headache. Oh my Lord, if there happens to be any number of people at all, I could probably say that in here today, and somebody's probably got a headache. That's not because God spoke it. And I hate to say it, but you know, Pat Robertson, they've done a lot of good work. But they've also done some silly things. Like just recently, he said God has shown him who's going to win the 2012 election, but he can't tell us. You know, first of all, there is a biblical precedent for God revealing who would be the next leader. But he doesn't do it that I can tell you, but you can't tell anybody. Every time there's a precedent for it in the Scripture, it's announced who's going to be the next one. Yeah, I mean, you know, I can do that. And after the election in November, I'll be like, that's the one. The problem is, folks, is that there are so many silly people out there that will believe that. And they'll be like, huh. But every one of us in this room have that ability to do that same thing if we wanted to do that and say, God showed us. And then Wednesday morning after the election, go, aha, there it is, that's the one. That's no proof to that at all. It's kind of like the night I was in the service and the guy asked us, one lady, he said, who is Homer? Only I just ask you this. If I looked at you all and said, God has revealed to me that you all know a man named Bob. How many of y'all know a man named Bob? Everyone in this room knows somebody named Bob. But check this out. Here's what he did. He said Homer. Okay, Homer's not a common name, but it is not uncommon to the point that no... And the lady was like, I have a neighbor down the street whose name is Homer. And he goes, did you tell me that? And she goes, no. And he turns around and looks at all of us and he says, there you go, folks. I am a man of God. No. That didn't make you a prophet. That means you've been simply to the school of thought that tells you that there are certain psychological things that you can say. But when you stand in front of somebody and God reveals something to you that you never knew and they know you didn't know and you speak it to them, there's a silly guy, and I'm going to move on real quickly, but there's a silly guy who has a school. And by the way, in the Bible, there is such a thing that is referred to as the school of the prophets. So don't be upset by that. There's a guy out in Kansas City who has a school of the prophets, and here's what he says. He says, I'm very proud of my young prophets. they are right 70% of the time. Only once, according to Scripture, do you have to be wrong. Say, God said, and it doesn't come true, and you're a false prophet. Now, regardless of all the shenanigans, this office is still a part of the church. Then there is that of evangelist, and that is the proclaimer. And by the way, I believe that in some way, shape, or form, every Christian is called to be a proclaimer. Amen? Every one of us have a testimony. Look what the Lord has done for you. Amen? Somebody needs to know what He has done for you. That of proclaimer. Now, this is not the same thing that we call an evangelist today, who basically is a hired gun that goes from church to church to church and preaches what we call revivals. A friend of mine, one time we were talking, he said, man, he said, my church it feels like everything is just dead. He said, I've really been tempted to bring in an evangelist and have a revival. Now, most churches, again, Beech Grove is not most churches. And if God leads, we'll do it. But most churches, especially Baptist churches, but the church I grew up in is the same way, most churches have a spring revival and they have a fall revival. Check it out. What does the word revive mean? Bring back to life. However, most revivals focus on salvations. And we try to get as many lost people to come to church as we can to get them saved, but the truth of the matter is, most revivals, we bring in such a dynamic preacher that we invite other Christians to come and hear the preacher preach. And so the church is generally packed with Christians and not sinners. So who have we made the thrust about? Christians. And yet the messages are to sinners to get saved. Now, check this out. If you want to call it a crusade where you're going to focus on lost people, do that. Nobody calls Billy Graham's services revivals, do they? They're called what? Crusades. What's the emphasis on? The lost. Sharing the gospel. Getting people saved. You don't have to agree with what he does or whatever his methods, but that's what the thrust is. So, we bring in this guy, and we have a revival, but the problem is that we're focusing on people who've never been vived. You have to be vived and die before you can get revived. Remember your English courses? Re means to what? Again. To do it again. Duh. And so I asked my friend, I said, we went through this whole little discourse about what revival means, revive. And so I said, here's my question, brother. What is wrong with us as pastors, or what is wrong with us as congregations, that from the fall revival to the spring revival, we die and we have to bring in a specialist to get us back to life again. And then as soon as the spring revival is over with, we have to, by the time fall gets here, we've got to have another specialist come in and revive us again, because we're dying twice a year. We're spending most of the year dead. Think about that. Is that really the purpose of the biblical evangelist? And the answer is no, it's not. The purpose of the biblical evangelist is to proclaim the gospel. Look this word up in the Greek, and evangelist means a proclaimer of the gospel. All right? Then there is this, pastor. And literally the word pastor is interpreted as shepherd. Okay? Now what all of us know, the 23rd Psalm, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He gives me the choice of whether or not I want to. What? Come on, help me out. He leads me beside the still waters. But first of all, it says, He maketh me to lie down. Can I tell you something? Sometimes God has to get a hold of us and force us down because we won't go down on our own. It's kind of like your little children. Kenton now is at that place. You know, when he's just, little bitty thing. I mean, he's not a lot. You know what I'm saying? When he's newborn, it's nap time. Off you go. Naomi can tell you now, though, when nap time starts coming around, that little boy doesn't go, woohoo, nap time, yes! Naomi, come tuck me in, I'm ready for a nap. Mommy, daddy, pappy, come tuck me in, I'm ready for a nap. No, he starts doing what? Yeah. I think that's a brown. You bundle him up, you bring him up next to you, you get in the rocking chair, whatever, and you try to give him a passy, or you try to, you know, give him a bottle, whatever, and he's like, just fighting. That's everyone who's ever had a baby. What happens? What do? You're like, well, okay. And unfortunately, there are some people that are like that. Well, okay, if you're going to throw a fit, then you don't have to. But what does the good shepherd do? When it's nap time, when it's bedtime, you don't give them a choice. They do, and that's sometimes what God has to do to you and I. He's the good shepherd. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. He restores my soul. Now, here's our problem. We can say we love the good shepherd, but the Scripture tells us that the pastor is the under-shepherd. And if he's the under-shepherd, what does he need to do? He needs to lead, but he also needs to be followed. All right? Then there's this one, that of teacher. And this word right here infers a master teacher. Now, I personally believe they go together. Okay? I wouldn't fight you either way if you want to say that this is a fifth office. I would not fight you either way. But folks, I want you to understand that the Word of God is filled from cover to cover with the concept of those who teach and those who need to be taught. It is centered around this idea of learning. But not just getting knowledge. Man, I know some people that are in their 40s or 50s that are still going to school. I'm not talking about people that started late. I'm talking about people that have never graduated. I had a friend of mine, his son had enough college hours to have 4 or 5 different degrees, and he was approaching 30 years old, and he still had no chance, or he had no thoughts of graduating. It wasn't finally until his mom and dad told him, said, listen, you graduate or get out. Okay? Now, there's a purpose to all this, but I want you to get something here real quick. I know some of you already know this, but in the Hebrew, the root words, after you take the prefixes and the suffixes off of the Hebrew word for teach, and you take the prefixes and suffixes off of the Hebrew word for learn, the root word for teach and learn is the same root word. In other words, they're not going to learn until you teach them. And they haven't learned until they've been taught. And so if people aren't learning, then there's something faulty with our teaching. Amen? Now, sometimes the unruly have to be taken out of the classroom. I was talking to a teacher the other day, and they had a situation where a student rose up and said, I'm not sitting in here. I'm going to do what I want to do. And for the sake of the rest of the class, they had to call somebody to come and take the student out. Amen? But the idea, folks, is that we teach for the purpose of learning so that we can be about the purpose of the ministry. All right, let's move on. These positions are not an end. Apostle, prophet, evangelist, pastor, teacher, they are not an end to themselves. They are a means to an end. And again, I go back to people who have held offices for the longest time but have never done what is required of the office. Can I tell you something? One of the greatest statements that I ever read in the Scriptures was in the book of Nehemiah. And it talks about how that Nehemiah got the call to go back from God, to go back and rebuild the walls of Jerusalem. And sometimes you need to just read that story. It's 10 chapters long. It's an awesome passage. Maybe it's 13 chapters. But anyway, it's an awesome story of the work of God and the grace of God at work in this man's life. And he goes back and he gets out of Jerusalem and he sees that the walls are torn down and the gates have been burned out. And he's humbled before God about it. And then he has a meeting with the people. And one of the things he said was this. He said, we surveyed it. We determined what had to be done. And then we got to it. And here's what he said. Because the people had a mind to work. In other words, the people said, we're going to do it. And then he begins to list the various different groups. This one repaired this section of the wall. This one repaired that gate, and this one repaired that section of the wall, and this one, and it got to this one group of people, and here's what it said. This forever has stuck in my mind. And the people labored on the wall, but their nobles, their leaders, did not help. What kind of example do you think that set for the people? When they were going out to do the work, and their leadership didn't show up. That's tough, isn't it? It's so tough that the Bible had it put in there so that you and I would see that there comes a time, folks, when if we have a position, it's more than the position we hold. It's the responsibility that comes with it. And sometimes we have to set our Bible, or you have to pick our Bible and set it under one arm and pick up a sword or a trowel in the other hand. A lot of people want to do and have the spiritual acclaim, but they don't want to put their hands on anything. I can remember years past that we had folks that wanted to sit over us and just, you know, criticize and judge everything we did. They wouldn't lift their finger to sweep a sidewalk, cut the grass. Amen? But I want you to understand something. There is more than just the spiritual work. Sometimes you got to get some dirt underneath your fingernails. But on the other hand, there are also those who think that their only responsibility is to do the physical things and never want to touch the spiritual side. It all goes together. And it starts with this idea of leadership. Watch this. These positions are not an end to themselves. They are means to an end, and that end is the perfecting of the saints. Everybody say that. The perfecting of the saints. Okay, I see some of y'all are still writing. You can't say, you can't. Does anybody else in the room have trouble chewing gum and walking at the same time? Not very many of us are amphibious. Amphibious, you know, you can do two things at once. All right, here you go. You ready? Say it with me. The perfecting of the saints. You mean God had a reason for establishing all this? Yes. Now check this out. How many of y'all are convinced that most of what our government does is to make somebody rich besides us? Like did any of you all, did your hair bristle this week when you heard that the president is asking Congress to give him the power to rearrange the government? And the pundits were on TV and they were saying, I would think that you Republicans and you conservatives would be passionate about this because you're all the time saying you want smaller government. But see, this is just rusty. I'm a skeptic. Is that okay? You guys okay? I'm a skeptic. And so when I hear the president saying he wants to rearrange it and make it smaller, what I hear him saying is, I want to get rid of everything that's against me and establish everything that's for me. Now that's just how I see it. Okay? But I hear people, and especially those on the left, they talk about the rich as if they are not. And you, do you know what? It's always easier to do it when you're spending other people's money. That's one of the problems with socialism, though, folks. Sooner or later, you run out of other people's money, and then you got to have some other way of getting money. And then what you end up doing is you turn the people into slaves so that you have all of their money. Read the book of Genesis, chapter 47. Amen? It happened once, it'll happen again. I'm convinced that our leadership, they don't have any problem with insider trading and making millions. Certain people who've been in office during the last 8 years, their wealth has more than doubled while they've been in office. Kind of, it reminds me of the story, and I know y'all haven't laughed a lot of my jokes here lately, but I'll try to come up with some new ones, but reminds me of the story of a man who was out knocking on doors and he was running for office and knocked on the door and a little lady answered the door and he said, ma'am, he said, I want you to know that in Washington, D.C., there's all kinds of sexual stuff going on. There's corruption, there's bribery, there's people stealing money. And she says, I suppose you're telling me that if I vote for you, you're going to go over and change it. He said, Lord, no, I want to go over and get in on it. Now, I am convinced, I love my country, but I don't trust this government, and when I say that, I don't trust the Republicans any more than I trust the Democrats. I don't trust the Libertarians, because I believe there are stuff going on that people in leadership ought to be screaming from the rooftops about. I don't believe in Fox News is the answer. They're giving you their slanted view. Amen? Now, when I say all that to say this, I want you to understand that God has not established the church for the apostle or the prophet or the pastor's personal gain either. The purpose of all of this is just for that bottom line, the perfecting of the saints. Now, when I make that comparison to the government, remember that the original idea of us having a government would be a government of the people, for the people, by the people. Amen? Now, God has established a heavenly government, if you will. He reigns on high. He has His Son sitting at His right hand. The Holy Spirit is at work in the world, working through the church. And in the church, He has apostles, He has prophets, He has evangelists, He has pastors and teachers for the perfecting of the saints. I cringe when I find out that the people that have made millions and millions on the ministry. And I think that someday we're going to stand before God and give an account. And one of the things we're going to give an account for is the scripture where Jesus said, freely you were given, and so freely you should give. I will not have people here who say, well, I'm going to have so much to come. Just an aside real quickly, but Steve Green, maybe y'all have never heard of him before. He passed away. He was one of the first of the contemporary Christians to be singing contemporary music. He passed away in the late 80s, I think it was. But he made a prophecy before he died. And he said, in the coming days, we will make Christian musicians. We will call them artists. And we'll promote them above the level of the preaching of the word. And they'll make more in single appearances than what some pastors or preachers basically are making in the course of an entire year's time. And if you've been associated with any of the stuff that we've done over the past years, you know we had one group who wanted to come to Youth Fest and to play an hour and 15-minute set. They wanted $40,000. And that was just to get them and their guitars and amplifiers here. That didn't include the sound system or the lighting or the stage or any of the other expenses. Now, people say, well, Brother Rusty, you... please. But then I find out there are preachers who, to get them to your church, the bottom offer is $20,000 plus their expenses to get there. And then you have to take up an offering for them. And I told you all the story about the guy. I said, man, the message was great. And I went up to him and I said, love to have you come to our church. Brother, fill out this card. He said, get a hold of this card right here. Get a hold of it. We'll be happy to set something up. And I said, our church is not a small church, but I wanted to say we're full of people that love the Lord. But before I could get that out, he said, hold on a second. He said, so that you don't waste my time and God's time. Really? What are we basing this on? Oh, wait a minute. Let me see. The scripture says, I think it's John chapter 4. I may be wrong. The scripture says that Jesus looked at his disciples and said, I need to go to Samaria. They were on their way someplace else, but he said, I need to go to Samaria. And then they said, we're hungry. I'm hungry. They left him sitting by a well. And while they were gone, one woman. Everybody say one woman. One woman showed up. He went to Samaria for one woman. Did he win their whole town? Yes. But he went there to get her. I want to tell you something this morning. The Lord cares for you. And He doesn't need a mega church to be able to reach your heart or to use your heart for His glory. This is all built around the perfecting of the saints. I've got to go on. Now, watch this because we're going to go quickly. The purpose of church leadership. First of all, it is to prepare the saints for the work of the ministry. Now, I like my Bible because my Bible took out a comma there that didn't belong in a lot of the other translations. And I probably, if you have any one of the modern translations, it also says the same thing. It says, He gave some, apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastor, teacher, for the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry. Not two separate things. The perfecting of the saints for the work of the ministry. Now, if that's true, who's supposed to do the work of the ministry? Who? The saints. In other words, the congregation. Now, you say, well, I don't know. That just seems like it's kind of pious and pompous, you know. Well, I'm glad you think that, but let me just give you a scriptural reference to it. In the book of Acts, the church had just kind of grown to this thousands and thousands of people. You know, the first time they gathered and they come out of the upper room, they had 3,000 saved. And the next time they come out on the streets, they had 5,000 saved. So that's 8,000 new Christians that they got to deal with. And they're trying to deal with them. And guess what? In the middle of all that dealing with new people, they started having problems. One of the first problems that rose up was racism. We don't like new things. And we especially don't seem to like new people. Because new people offer all sorts of challenges to us, don't they? And so they had this issue. And they came clamoring to the apostles and they said, listen, what are you going to do about this? And here's what they said. They said, look, we don't need to be waiting on tables. In other words, we don't need to be doing the stuff like this. We need to be able to spend time with God and study. And so here's what we need to do. We need to set amongst yourselves, find seven people who are full of the Holy Ghost, who have a good report among the people, they're full of faith, and set them aside and let them be deacons. And the deacons is the word diakonos, which translates not church leader, but church servant. And let them take care of this. Now, today, the office of deacon, especially in the Baptist church, is so far away from that of Scripture that it's pathetic. Because now, in the Baptist church, the deacons run the church, and the pastors do the work of the ministry. It's true. It's true. There's very few churches. I can tell you this man right here, Brother Tim, whenever he was the chairman of the deacons, it wasn't that way. It's the first church I ever knew that grew under an interim pastor. I don't even know if you remember we're on Sunday, brother. I was down there. I was invited to come and speak at your men's breakfast on a Sunday morning. And while I was there, they didn't even ask me to leave. I wanted to leave, but they said for me to stay. They held a deacons meeting. And the whole time, they never talked about a single person. They never talked about the pastor. They talked about the people that needed to be helped. Amen? I didn't think I'd remember that, but it stuck forever in my mind. You see, we put the emphasis on our titles, going back to what I said previously. But the fact of the matter is that the church needs to be prepared to do the work of the ministry. Now check this out. If I only come to get ministered to, am I ever then going to do the work that I've been called to do? No. Eventually, I have to come out of being ministered to and get into ministering to somebody. Amen? Sometimes pastors need ministering. Amen? Sometimes I get it here. Sometimes I get it other places. But the fact of the matter is, there's only one reason for you or I to be ministered to, and that is so that we can go out and be a minister. All right? Second part is to build or strengthen the church. Folks, listen. We've gone through some shrinkage. We've gone through some division. We've gone through some subtraction, I should say. But sooner or later, if we're doing what's right, the church needs to start growing again. But not growing with people leaving other ministries and coming here. And I say this without shame, but most of these mega churches around us, and it's not in jealousy when I say this, but most of the mega churches around us, if they had to stop relying on people leaving churches and coming there and rely solely on their ability to win souls, they would have to stop tomorrow. Amen? Now, if you're saved and God leads you to come here, that's one thing entirely different. But I tell you, most of what the church does in its what we call evangelism efforts, in reality, is we're trying to attract other Christians to come to our church. Have you ever listened to the advertisements? I challenge you sometime. Listen to them. Listen on WJIE. Again, I ask you, who listens to WJIE? Not personally, but overall. Who listens to WJIE? Christians. How many of you all, before you were saved, what did you listen to? Did you listen to Christian radio? Rock and roll, baby. Country music. Hip-hop. Some of the devil. But do you remember? Do you remember ever going down the road and beating the stereo because the Christian radio station just went out of range? No. No. Well, because you weren't interested in listening to Christian music or Christian preaching or teaching. Okay? So then if lost people are not listening to that and we're running commercials on there for our church, who are we trying to reach? Christians. Then what are we trying to do? We're trying to get them to leave the ship they're in and come over and get in our ship. I mean, think about it. And we spend thousands upon millions of dollars every year. We've bought into this advertising on there. And the churches are on there, and we're spreading our word. But the truth of the matter is, we're only reaching other Christians. So in other words, what we're doing is we're pouring salt on what has already been salted. If you put too much salt on it, what is it good for? Nothing. As a matter of fact, salt on salt will eventually turn into stale salt, which Jesus said was worth nothing except to be walked on. Maybe that's why the church is getting walked on today. I listened this morning. I was telling the Sunday school class, church, they're going to start doing a TV program on Sunday morning. And that's how they're going to reach the unchurched. No, they're not. Well, preacher, what about if they reach one? Okay, but I can promise you this. You take a church that has 20,000 members and send a tenth of those people out. That'd be 2,000. Send a tenth of them out on the streets, knocking on doors and handing out tracts, and you'll bring in many more people than you would spending thousands and thousands of dollars each month on TV. Now, am I against TV? No, because there are a lot of people who can't go to church that can stay at home and watch a good program. I mean, while they're at home and convalescing. But I want to tell you this. If you happen to be of the ilk and say, well, you know what? I thank God I don't have to go to church. I'll stay at home and watch TV. No. Get up, get out, and do the work of the Lord. Now, the church needs to be built and strengthened. Thirdly, to bring us into the unity of the faith. My Lord, I'm not talking about just blindly following. But you know, again, I say what I said last Sunday. There are some things that you don't need to say. There are some disagreements that we don't need to have. And again, I go back to what I said last Sunday, but every guy in the church knows what I'm about to say is the truth. You don't have to tell her every time she cooks something you don't like. I didn't see any elbows flying right then, did I? Yeah. And if you do say you do like it and you didn't really, I believe there's a special dispensation for that. I'm not sure that that really qualifies as a lie. Somebody's going to say, I'm going to get an email over that. Somebody's going to say, you just told people they can lie from the pulpit of the church. I'm telling you something. If it is a lie, I believe God will forgive you for it. Because the Bible does say, in all things use wisdom. You know, just once watching the Food Network, just once, I'd like to see them after they make something and they take a bite. Have you ever watched them? They take a bite and they go, oh, that is so awesome. I just once would like to see them take a bite and spit it out. Go, oh my God, that was terrible. You think that they get those recipes right every single time? No. But there are some times, if she walks in and she says, do these jeans make me look too fat? Yeah, but here's the fact of the matter is that there are some things, guys, that you might be thinking, but you don't need to say. And there are some things that get voiced, not necessarily to the person that it should be voiced to, but there are some things that we give voice to. And I'm telling you something, I'm speaking from personal experience, that do not promote the unity of the faith. And in the overall scheme, I'm not talking about if somebody's stealing money. I'm not talking about if somebody is going out and committing adultery. You know, I'm not talking about, you know what I'm talking about. I'm talking about things that just, in the light of eternity, there are some things that some people don't need to know that you know about. Because that knowledge will disrupt the unity. There are some things that I have dear friends in the ministry that I don't agree with them about. But is that enough for me to stop doing ministry with them over? No. They believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of the risen God. Amen. They believe that he was born of the Virgin. They believe he died on the cross, was buried, and rose again. No, I don't believe in Easter. But if they do, that doesn't mean that I'm going to fall out with them over that. Or other different aspects of things. There are just some things that when it comes to dividing us over the unity of the faith, we need to set some things aside. This is a part of who we're supposed to grow into. I got to hurry. To teach the knowledge of the Son of God. You know, as I look at that, I thought, man, what does that mean? Everybody knows Jesus. Do we? I mean, come on. Any of you that have been out on the streets at all, you know there's going to be somebody who staggers up and they say this. Come on, you know it. You've rehearsed it with me. I'm a Christian. But I don't think you have to do all this. Or some of them are stone cold sober and they walk up and go, I'm a Christian. Do you know, I think you guys need to take this back to the church. What would be the purpose of that statement? Especially to a person who is stone cold sober. And it would just simply be this, I think, that your being out there reminds their guilty conscience that they are not doing what they ought to be doing, which is sharing the gospel of Jesus Christ. Well, Brother Rusty, I don't know if I'm supposed to be out on the streets. I know this. I do believe that you are. But I know this, not every person is comfortable running out there right off the bat. And there are some baby steps that we can take to get you out there. But the fact of the matter is that Paul said part of our job as leaders is to teach people the knowledge of the Son of God. Do you really know who Jesus is? Well, he come down at Christmas time and he was born in a manger and the wise men and the shepherds and the camels and the donkeys were all there. And if he sees his shadow, well, there's 6 more weeks of winter. That's not much further than adding the shepherds to the manger scene. I mean, think about it. You say, well, I'm not that silly. I don't believe that about Jesus coming out of the tomb and seeing his shadow. But I want you to know that there is a lot of Christendom that doesn't have much more wisdom than that. They don't really know. They don't know that people can be free. All they know about salvation is that when they die, they're going to go to heaven. But they have to live through hell for the rest of their lives. That's not salvation. He came to save us, not in our sins, but he came to save us from our sins. The angel told Mary, you shall call his name Jesus, Yahshua, Yeshua. And this is what he said that name means. For he shall save his people from their sins. Okay? Yahshua. Okay? Yahshua is Hebrew for Jesus. It's also Hebrew for Joshua. Now, what do the two have in common? Joshua actually led the children of Israel across the river and into the promised land. Think about that for a minute. See, a lot of people don't know. We don't know anything other than the name Jesus. We have no clue what it means. The church needs to proclaim his name in its fullness. Then we are to bring about the maturity of the saints. And when it talks about the maturity of the saints, it talks about that we are grown up into what we are supposed to grow up into. Let me hurry on. To realize the fullness of Christ in our lives. Not everybody knows what they ought to be in Christ Jesus. I believe, folks, that God has so much more for us than what we've ever tapped into. We don't even have a clue what all we're missing. And then Paul says that we should lose our petty childishness, which leads to deception with every new thing that comes along. Notice what he said. That was my way of putting it. But here's what he said. That we be no more children tossed about by every wind of doctrine with the sleight of hand, the cunningness, the craftiness, the deception of men. Folks, I want you to know something. There are people out there who are devising new doctrines every day so that they can write another book about it or make some more money off of it and they can get on TV and do something else. Trust me, in 20 plus years of doing it, and any of you all that have been around this thing at all, you know that there's somebody out there right now that's writing a new book about something new. I mean, you had the guy down in Florida, come here from South Africa, I think it was, and he was the Holy Ghost bartender. And in this day and time, when deception is running rampant on the earth, and the wrath of God is being poured out all across this world, and people are dropping to hell every second, he said the Holy Ghost was coming along and giving people a spirit of laughter. And I think just the opposite should have been happening. Instead of the Holy Ghost coming in and having us laying on the floor giggling like idiots, he should have been breaking our hearts and putting us on our faces to seek the face of God. Fred Sheridan wrote something the other day on his Facebook page and posted it and said, when was the last time you couldn't sleep at night because people were going to hell? There's something about the fact that I think it breaks the heart of God that his church is so easily deceived. And the reason why he said that so is because we're still acting like children. Real quick, I'm about done. He said, speak the truth in love. Sometimes people don't like what you have to say. Amen? Sometimes people don't like what you have to say. But sometimes people don't like how you say it. Now, I know not everybody that disagrees with us. I know that one of the first times I was down there at Mardi Gras, we were standing outside of a gay bar and we were preaching. And the guys, they weren't even preaching. They made sure, just so that they couldn't give offense, they made sure that they weren't preaching against homosexuality. Man, they were just preaching the gospel and preaching the truth about being set free from sin. And this guy just kept standing there and screaming and heckling. So finally, I just walked over to him. I said, "Buddy," I said, "what's going on, man?" And he said, "You guys are just hateful." And I said, "Really?" And he said, "Yeah, you're just hateful." And I said, "Can you tell me one thing we've said that's hateful?" And he just stopped and he looked at me. And I said, "They haven't said the first thing about homosexuality. They haven't said anything at all about gays or anything about anything of that." And then he looked at me and he said, "Well, it just seems like you were going to." Now, I can't help it if a person is living in sin and we speak the truth in love about their sin and they don't like that. I can't help that. Amen? Nobody, no, you just can't help it. That's just how it lays. But let me just say this. What if somebody says, I don't think that dress looks good on you. Now, if they say it in the right tone, what would you say? Maybe there's something wrong with how the dress looks. Now, if Larry's wearing the dress, something's bad wrong with the whole picture. Okay? But check this out. What if you say this? "I don't like how that dress looks on you." What has happened? It wasn't just only what you said, it was how you said it. Now check this out. A person who is the enemy of God, a person who hates God, they're going to be offended if you say God loves you no matter how you say it. But a person who the Holy Spirit might be dealing with, if you look at them and you go, "God loves you, and if you don't give your heart to Him, you're going to..." Chances are, it's not going to be what you said, because they probably didn't even hear what you said. They only heard how you were saying it. I've been on the streets now for going close to 10 years, I guess, doing different types of ministry like that, going down to Thunder, handing out tracts, different stuff like that. And I've watched people go down to the Derby sometime. That group, I guarantee you, they'll be down there this year. Last year, they got right down in front of the main gate and they were holding up signs. The Bible says a woman's place is in the home. I thought of all the scriptures they could have chose to put on a sign and go down to be a witness for Jesus Christ. What would have hurt to have gone down there with, "For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in Him should not perish but have everlasting life." All they did was go down there to pick a fight. Friends, I want you to note something. That's not speaking the truth in love. That's you, that's me, that's whoever it is being in love with their fact. I know guys, and I just had to take them off my stuff, man. But they could talk about, their greatest thrill was that they went somewhere and got thrown out for preaching. Or they went somewhere and got punched in the nose for preaching. But if you listen or watch what they're preaching, there's nothing at all about the gospel and what they're saying. I got a beer thrown on me down at Thunder 2 years ago because a guy was over there telling all the soldiers that they were murderers because being in the military made you a murderer. I went charging over when I heard about it because I'm a veteran and I support our military. Amen. A guy I graduated with this past weekend, his son was killed in Afghanistan. Right? Next Saturday is going to be the memorial service for his son. 27 years old, had a family. He got killed by an IED, and another boy from Indiana was killed with him also. All right? I'm a veteran. I support these troops. And I went over, and before I could find out what had happened, this guy thought I was part of it, so he just threw a 32-ounce beer all over me and then turned and ran. Later on, I was able to finally talk to the guy, and you might think it's wrong of me to do it, but I told him, I said, buddy, you threw the beer on the wrong person. If you'd like, I'll walk over here and I'll buy you a beer. So I hated for him to waste his beer on me. He should have hit that other guy. And after I found out what the other guy was saying, I would have thrown it on him for him too. Because I want to get away from that kind of nonsense, folks. Amen. If you want to tell me that war is wrong, you're going to have to tell me that this book is entirely wrong, because this Bible tells us that our God is a God of war. He's a man of war. Amen. Remember what Jesus said? He said, don't think I came to bring peace. He said, as a matter of fact, you that have one sword, go and sell something and get you a second one. I mean, there are some times when you've got to put your Bible down and go to hitting people. Listen, I want to tell you men something in this room. If somebody came into your home and started to attack your home, and you didn't do something to them to defend your home, as your preacher, I'd be ashamed of you. Amen? But you can't be like the guy up in Louisville just recently I heard about. A guy tried to rob his home, and the guy ran out down the road trying to get away, and the guy chased him two blocks down the road and shot him in the head. Amen? Same fashion. We're not called, as Christians, we're not called to take this book and go out and beat people in the face with it. But in the face of that, we are called to take this book and go out and preach its truth in love. Amen? Last one. I'm done. Remember, it is in Christ and Christ alone that we stand. I said this last Sunday morning. I say it again today. On Christ the solid rock I stand. All other ground is sinking sand. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. On Christ the solid rock I stand. All other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. Stand with me, would you please? Wow. Just ask a question really quickly. I look around this room and I know every person in this room at one point in time or another has said, I am a Christian, Pastor. I'm a Christian. I'm going to ask you this morning. Is it well with your souls? Is it well with your souls? Is there anybody here who would say, you know what, preacher, I got to say, man, it's not well with my soul right now. It's not well with my soul. Would you all please pray for me? Anybody at all? So with confidence, should today be the day we have to stand before the Lord, you can say, I am His and He is mine. Amen? Praise the Lord. When I ask you this question, is there anybody here who would say, you know what, Pastor, I need to just work in falling in line. I want to get to where God wants me to be at. I want to find my place in the body of Christ and do. Because remember what that scripture says. Every part, amen, God bless your hearts. Every part supplying, the body is supported by every joint supplying it, what every part gives to it. Every one of us have a purpose. It's not just to fill a seat. It's not just to drop some money in the plate. Every one of us have a purpose in this body. Grab your neighbor by the hand. Just grab your neighbor by the hand. Yeah, some of you might have to move to get to somebody. That's okay. That's okay. Amen. Lord God, I just thank you for your people. Lord, I know I've held them long today, but they've been such a good group to preach to. Lord, I thank you for your word, but I thank you for your church, that you've given us a place and you've given us a people. God, I thank you that on a cold, snowy day, they've made their way out here in the middle of nowhere to worship and to hear from you. God, I pray that it wasn't a waste of time. Lord, I just ask you that you would work in each one of us. Lord, as you have never left us or forsaken us, Lord, don't leave us now. Help us that we may grow up to be what you want us to be. Help us that we may grow up to accomplish what you put us here to do. Lord, that someday we can stand before you as a group of people and hear you say, well done, my good and faithful servants. Beech Grove, come on in. Lord, I know that someday I'm going to stand and give an account for this group. And I just ask you, God, that you would help me to do my best, do my part to be faithful to your word and faithful to the truth. pray this in Jesus' holy and precious name. And all the people said,